Yes, inflation in industrialized nations is far above their central bank's targets of 2%. And yes, for the last 15 years, these same central banks have been using quantitative easing programs with the aim of increasing inflation. And yet, in this video, I'm going to show you why quantitative easing, or QE for short, is not responsible for the high inflation that we see today. So let's get into the mind of a central banker and see how they think about inflation and how it relates to quantitative easing.
Inflation is very, very low, which you think is a good thing, and normally is a good thing, but we're getting awfully close to the range where prices would actually start falling.
Falling prices lead to falling wages, it lets the steam out of the economy, and you start spiraling downward.
Exactly.
Okay, so the idea is that deflation is bad because it might devolve into a deflationary downward spiral, also known as debt deflation. But that doesn't yet explain why we might need QE. To get to that point, we first need to understand how central bankers think that inflation comes about.
The total amount of spending affects the rate of inflation. Too much, and inflation can rise as the economy overheats. Too little, and inflation can fall as the economy contracts.
Okay, so to control inflation, central bankers believed that they needed to control the total amount of spending related to the productive capacity of the economy. And how would they go about doing that? Well, they originally thought that they could control spending by controlling the interest rate.
To stop prices rising too fast, the bank reduces the amount of spending in the economy by adjusting the cost of money. It does this by setting the interest rate on its dealings with financial institutions. This in turn affects the rate on savings, mortgages, overdrafts, and other loans. All of this influences how much is spent and saved, and in turn, inflation.
Central bankers call this framework of increasing interest rates when inflation is too high and lowering them when inflation is too low, inflation targeting. And you know what? After adopting it in the 1990s, in most countries, inflation actually became really low and stable. So of course, central bankers thought that they had completely figured out how inflation works and how to control it with interest rate changes. And when inflation was low in the 2000s, following their playbook, they had to lower interest rates. Sure, house and stock prices were going up like crazy, but there was no consumer price inflation, and so there was nothing to worry about. Of course, we all know how this story ended.
Let's talk about the speed with which we are watching this market deteriorate.
What started in America last year has now spread to every part of the world.
This could be the most serious recession in decades.
And that meant that people stopped spending, risking a deflationary spiral. So the central banker's playbook advice was again very simple, just lower the interest rate charged to financial institutions. But soon the problem was that these were already at zero and thus they couldn't really go much lower. Why not, you might ask? The reason is cash, which by its very nature has an interest rate of 0%. So basically, if central bankers were to reduce rates too far below zero, then they would risk a run on the banks. In central bank technical speak, the interest rate had hit the zero lower bound. And this is when central bankers noticed that while sure, the rate that they charged to financial institutions had hit the zero lower bound, the rates that these financial institutions charged on longer term loans, like for example, mortgages and car loans, had not yet reached zero. So then they just needed to figure out a clever new way to get banks to reduce these rates as well. The solution that they came up with was QE. In practice, this meant buying a lot of long-term assets with newly created bank reserves. This is where the money printing meme comes from. But for central bankers, this wasn't really about increasing government spending. Instead, the idea was to take long-term assets out of the economy and put short-term, low-interest rate assets back into the economy. This way, they figured the price of these long-term assets would rise and by implication, the interest rates on them would fall. This makes total intuitive sense, right? Massive bond buying with new reserves increases the price of bonds. Then central bankers could just go back to their old framework of controlling relative spending in the economy through interest rates. The only difference was that they now did so through both short-term and long-term interest rates. However, this begs the question, did this actually work? To see if financial market prices were actually impacted by QE, economists tend to rely on something they call event studies. In an event study, researchers will study the impact of an unexpected announcement of more QE on the prices of several financial assets. This announcement has to be unexpected because otherwise the impact of QE would already have been reflected in the prices of financial markets. Pretty clever, right? And the good news for central bankers is that in most of these studies, researchers found a substantial impact of QE on asset prices. So the first part of that central banker story actually seems to hold up to scrutiny. In fact, you could say that QE has had such a massive impact on financial markets that it amounts to distortions, making an investment in it much harder. And that brings us to the sponsor of this video, the YouTube channel Market Insider. Market Insider publishes educational videos about different companies and how they operate in the market. For example, in one of their recent videos, they discussed the story behind the $900 million debt of Cirque du Soleil. You should definitely check it out. Importantly to me, they published their sources in the description of the videos, so you can make up your own mind about the videos as well. I will publish a link in the description of this video below, so go check out their channel after finding out why quantitative easing failed to cause inflation. So we've now seen that the QE did in fact work according to the first part of its intended purpose. But did it cause inflation? Of course, central bankers would say that
when we look at the purpose we had, which was making sure that the inflation outlook is satisfactory, or at least aims towards a satisfactory direction, I think we can conclude that it has been effective.
And if we look at the high levels of inflation that we see today, it sounds very logical. But this is the Money and Macro channel. It's not good enough for something to just sound logical. So let's have a look at what researchers that went through years and years of inflation and QE data in the industrialized economies found. And the answer is no, QE has not been very effective. Sure, some studies found that it likely had some effect on spending and inflation, but it just wasn't very big. Now you might say, Joeri, these studies were conducted before the pandemic, and now we do have high inflation, which is just a logical conclusion after so many years of QE. However, if we just do a simple sanity check, we can clearly see in the US that while there were many QE programs that inflated the balance sheet size of the central bank, inflation of consumer prices just stayed roughly around the same level. And it's only now after a massive pandemic with global lockdowns and supply chain disruptions that we see higher inflation. Furthermore, if QE was really to blame for US and European inflation today, then we should have also seen this in Japan, where the central bank went on the biggest buying spree of all of them, and inflation was just fluctuating around 0%. So yeah, linking our current inflation to QE is just a really tough case to make. But that does beg the question, why were central bankers so wrong about how much their QE programs would influence inflation? Well, I think that the most convincing explanation relies on the fact that our economies have become much more financialized. This basically means that transactions for financial speculation have become much more important. So lower interest rates across the board induced by QE likely did cause more spending. It just did not cause that much extra spending on consumer goods, and therefore it did not cause consumer price inflation. Instead, QE caused increased spending on financial assets such as homes, stocks, and ironically, cryptocurrencies. Therefore, it did cause massive asset price inflation. And it is precisely these inflated asset prices that mean that even though consumer price inflation is now very high, central bankers are still super cautious to withdraw their quantitative easing programs. They just don't want to risk another global financial crisis. But then, if it wasn't QE, what is causing today's inflation? Well, for that, I made a deep dive video that you can check out over here. Also, even though I kept using the money printing meme in the video, it was just too much fun to resist. QE is not the same as money printing, and to find out why, check out this video over here. Finally, if you want to support research-based economic content such as this, then consider supporting the channel via Patreon or Ko-fi links in the description.